The name of this video is Classification of Magnetic Materials. As we did in the case of dielectric materials, also in the case of magnetic materials, we need to provide the constitutive relations for B and H, that is the relationship, constitutive relation between B and H. Theoretically, this is a rather hard problem. Therefore, we are going to proceed by summarizing what people have done empirically, that is, by means of experiments. And so we'll consider a material under test, which is our magnetic material. Material under test is MUT, in brief, in material science. And we assume that this material is isotropic if it were anisotropic, as we have seen both for conductors in the case of Hamming conductors and for dielectric materials, then we need to consider second order tensors, which we will not do in this course. So we consider this material to be isotropic, that this is the same if I'm inside the material and I look everywhere in space, I see the same distribution of atoms, and so it's isotropic. In addition, we consider it to be homogeneous, that is, we are considering the same material. However, we are considering this material to be, in general, non-linear. So we are not considering yet an ILH material, but an IH, but without L, is non-linear. In fact, the fact that this material is isotropic and homogeneous suffices to allow us to use the same symmetries we use in free space in vacuum. Symmetries can be used. The nolinearity does not preclude us from using symmetries because the key for symmetries is isotropic and homogeneous. Now, let us perform a Gedanken experiment. Where, in this experiment, in this thought experiment, we consider to have a toroidal solenoid, which we have discussed in Phys 242 at the end. So this solenoid looks like this toroidal solenoid, so we need to sketch a torus. In 3D, I will attempt to do so. So this is our torus, our donut, if you want, which we create by rotating a circle about a rotational axis. Which we call, simply in this case, the Z axis. And let's suppose that this is the origin of this of a cylindrical coordinate system. This is the radial direction r. Therefore, right-hand rule, this has to be var phi. So we are using a cylindrical coordinate system for a toroidal solenoid. In fact, the core of the solenoid, which is the torus itself, Let's assume that the torus itself is made from entirely our MUT, the material under test. For example, here you could put magnetite or silver, whatever you like in the shape of this torus, the material you want to study. And so this is our axis here of the torus, which again we studied in 242 in detail. Great. So now let's suppose that we wind up a conducting wire with a current, a steady current IC. IC because it's conducting, because we're only considering a conducting wire. So the wire looks like this. Etc. So this is our conducting wire, and suppose that we consider a current flowing in this direction. So this is our current IC, purely intensity, of course, in this case, current intensity IC, purely conductive. So we have a conductive current, and suppose that we coil up capital N loops for this wire, which again are all equally spaced. If you look back at 242 or on YouTube, they have to be equally spaced, and so that everything is very uniform, bottom line. Okay, so under these conditions, clearly, if you go back and check the video on the toroidal solenoid back in 242, the symmetries, obviously in this case, we expect, in case of isotropic and homogeneous materials, that the symmetries we used in that video for B, they must apply also to H. And in fact, we can argue that H, in this case, if we remember what was B, which is one of the fundamental results of 242, well, we know that for a toroidal solenoid, B is the same as the field of an infinite straight line with a current I on it. But in this case, the current is not just I, is N loops times I. And of course, it goes in the direction of bar phi. So in this case, we expect H to be similar to B. So we will have N times IC in the numerator, which is the total current, divided by 2 pi R, the field of an infinite straight line, times U bar phi. Note that in this case, we do not have mu naught, because we are not writing B, in which case you have 1 over mu naught, we are writing H, and by the definition of H, somehow we get rid of that mu naught. Great. So now the interesting thing here is that this quantity IC actually represents, which of course, by setting IC, we set H effectively, and this is our knob, is the knob of the experiment, is the knob we can turn up and down. By changing it, we change effectively H. H is the auxiliary free magnetic field, depends only on IC. So that's what we're doing. We're using H because H is independent of any magnetization, which is what eventually we want to study now, by means of this experiment. So this is our knob, we change IC, which is in our hands, is the current from the outlet, and we get a different H. So that's exactly what's going on here. All right, so this is our knob. So now, which means this is our x-axis, if you want, in our constitutive relation. What about the y-axis? How do we measure the y-axis? Well, the y-axis, so this is our x-axis. Obviously, the y-axis has to be B. That is the magnitude of B vector, the norm of B vector. Great. How do we measure the norm of B vector? This can be done, for example, by means of, so we can measure it by means of a flux meter. So flux meter is a device which allows us to measure the flux. For example, in my experiments, we use a SQUID in principle to measure extremely small fluxes. A SQUID is a superconducting quantum interference device, a little loop, superconducting in our case, which allows us to measure fluxes. And so if the loop is very small, characterized by a small area delta A, a physics infinitesimal if you want, well, in this case, it so happens that the flux is given by the area delta A times B, but B times delta A more properly. So it's B times delta A, definition of flux, but this is a physics infinitesimal, so we can really, if we use a very fine flux meter, this very fine flux meter will allow us to measure B basically locally, okay, in the neighborhood of any point capital P in space, where we want to measure it. And so from this, clearly, we can measure B as the flux divided by delta A, and this gives us B. So this is the procedure by which we measure it. So we have a toroidal solenoid. The core is made of, let's say, magnetite, which is the material of your fridge magnet. Around it, we coil up a conductor, a wire, which is conductor in a very homogeneous fashion with capital N loops, where we apply a conducting current, which is our knob. We can change it in the experiment with a source. We measure locally at each point inside this object. So this little a is basically this area here, delta A, if you want. We measure locally the flux due to the B field. By dividing the flux by delta A, of course, we obtain B. And so now we can plot point by point, we can plot the constitutive relation of this object, of this MUT. And so the constitutive relation will look, if we perform these measurements for many materials, for example, I will give you a few examples in a minute, it will look as follows. So in the x-axis, we have H, which effectively is I, C, but let's call it H, whereas in the y-axis, we have B, what we measure here is the origin. So if the core of the torus is vacuum, we would measure nothing but mu naught, which is the permeability of vacuum, so the vacuum permeability. Instead, if we were to measure something less than mu naught, so a straight line with a delta y over delta x equal to a quantity mu less than mu naught, this material is called diamagnetic. If instead we measure characteristic which is larger than mu naught, in this case, the material is called paramagnetic. So in the simplest case, note that for now, I confine myself within the realm of linear materials for a minute. We will study the nonlinear in the next video. So if we are lucky and we study eventually a linear material, because by luck, we managed to put in the chorus a linear material, and again, we will study the nonlinear in the next video, then we can find three types of linear materials. Diamagnetic materials, for which we measure a mu, which is less than mu naught, vacuum, in which case we measure mu naught, and paramagnetic materials for which mu is larger than mu naught. What does it mean here? So obviously this means that the relationship between B and H is of the type B, linear of course, let's put even a vector in this case, is given by a quantity mu in general times H. This is the relationship, the constitutive relation that we find purely linear up until now. So let me give you a few examples here. So for example, material such as, so if we fill this toroidal solenoid with copper, silver, bismuth, or graphite, for example, so copper, bismuth, silver, and graphite, they are characterized by a mu less than mu naught. So now here, okay, so in this case, we have mu less than mu naught. It is worth defining a quantity let's define it here, mu r relative mu, which is given by mu divided by mu naught. So if we use this mu relative, which is similar to epsilon relative, which was epsilon over epsilon naught, so this is mu relative. So by using this definition here for mu relative, this means that mu relative is less than one. And as it turns out, for these materials, actually, mu r is approximately one minus a very small quantity, 10 to the minus 5. So it's almost one. It's just one minus a quantity which is 10 to the minus 5. So these materials are actually very close to vacuum. And in fact, similarly, so these are diamagnetic materials. Instead, materials such as aluminum, platinum, air. So aluminum, platinum, air, etc. These materials are paramagnetic. So in this case, it so happens the mu is larger than mu naught. And in particular, mu r is larger than one. And typically, this mu r is approximately equal to 1 plus a little bit larger than 1, but by a very small quantity, in fact, even smaller, 10, well, even a little bit larger, 10 to the minus 4. 10 to the minus 4. All right. And these are called paramagnetic again. So these materials are paramagnetic, as we already said here. So what is interesting is that all these diamagnetic and paramagnetic materials, they all behave approximately like vacuum. That is, if I consider copper and I apply a magnetic field, the magnetic field almost doesn't notice that there is copper. In many experiments, we can basically consider this transparent for them. So they're like vacuum. Okay, similarly for silver, even though it's paramagnetic. Then, of course, you can study in detail all these phenomena, but in general, they behave like vacuum, so they are not super critical. So diamagnetic material, in fact, is the corresponding, in the case of magnetic materials, of dielectric materials. But in the case of dielectric materials, we saw that these, they make a huge difference to define electric field. Whereas diamagnetic materials, not so much, because look here, they're almost like vacuum. However, in the case of magnetic materials, the case of most interest is when we consider a non-linear material. For example, magnetite, which is iron oxide, okay, like the magnet you put on your fridge. Or iron or nickel or cobalt, which are all non-linear materials because they are ferromagnetic. And so in the next video, we are going to study exactly the case of non-linear materials. So let's summarize this video here. Classification of magnetic materials. We intend to find a constitutive relation which relates B to H. How do we do it? By means of experiments, because to do the theory of that would be pretty complicated in this course. So we consider a material which is isotropic and homogeneous. It could be non-linear. In the beginning, in the first video, we do the linear case. And so the symmetries, regardless whether the material is linear or not, still applies. And so we consider for this experiment the toroidal solenoid. The core of this torus is the material under test, MUT, for example, copper, let's say, or platinum. And then we coil up a conducting material around it where we apply a current IC, which is a conducting current with intensity IC and is steady. Under these conditions, we know that since the symmetries for B and H are the same, H is basically like B, The only difference is that we don't multiply times mu naught. And so H depends on NIC, which is the total current. It's like the field of an infinite straight line. That's why we use a cylindrical coordinate system divided by 2 pi r in the direction of bar phi tangent. This current is our knob, that is H, is on the x-axis, whereas on the b-axis, by means of a flux meter, we measure the flux. For linear materials such as those, we get a straight line. Vacuum is 45 degrees, less is the magnetic materials, more is paramagnetic materials. Both of them are very close to vacuum, as you've seen in these examples. In the next video, we are going to study non-linear materials. That's it!